study your word, to fellowship, to sing, to read, to take some notes and remember, to be thankful, to place our past in your hands as we wrap up a year and put our future in your hands as we step towards the future year. Lord, it is good to be in your house with our brothers and our sisters today. And all God's people said, amen. It is good to be together this morning, loved ones. Good morning and welcome to worship. And pray for all those people who are going through the last Sunday of the year, skip church blues. But we do have some folks who are not feeling well as well. So if you're not seeing someone here this morning, you pray for them, won't you? I know Walter's not feeling too terribly well, and there are others who have aches and pains. A couple people took falls in parking lots this week, and pray for achy bones and backs and knees and all the above. So all God's people said amen, but they also said, hello, good morning, how are you? It's good to see you. Let's have a moment of friendship, shall we? And say good morning, give away a few hugs and handshakes, and it's good to see you this morning. Well, I have a couple questions for you as we prepare here to continue to worship in just a moment with the song. Were you able to greet and meet today the missionaries who are here from a little village outside of Nome? Were you able to welcome and greet the missionary from Fred Meyer? Or the missionary from the State Department offices? Or the missionary who is a teacher's aide in a school here? The missionary who works at UAA, or the missionary who is a daycare provider, or the missionary who's retired over in our apartments over here, or the missionary who's in the military, or a missionary who works at Xerox. Did you meet all these missionaries? I hope that you did. And the other missionary who's retired, because each and every one of us are here as missionaries, amen? we shine and reflect his light and what he has done. And the gal who keeps all those lawyers in, it's nice to have a missionary in a lawyer's office, you know. However, the joyful part is some of those lawyers are Christians, aren't they? And that's a blessing too. Well, loved ones, let's continue to worship the Lord. Shall we, missionaries together? Oh, there's a couple missionaries from Grace Elementary Christian School here. Good morning, gentlemen. You know you're a missionary at your school, don't you? Good, good. Let's sing to the Lord, shall we? Marsha, will you help with the keyboard? We're going to sing Good Christian Men Rejoice. Oh, let's stand together, Charlie. Good Christian men and women, rejoice.
Men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Give ye heed to what we say. News, news. Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and ass before him bow. He is in the manger now. Christ is born today. Christ is born today.
Thank you, Lord.
Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye hear of endless bliss. Joy, 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 joy. Jesus Christ was born for this.
He hath opened the heavenly door.
And man is blessed evermore. Christ was born for this. Christ was born for this. Jesus Christ is born to save. He calls you on and calls you home. He gave his everlasting heart. Christ was born to save.
Hope is in you, Lord.
in you. Our future is in you. Our present today, each and every breath, is a gift from you, Lord. Help us to use it to sing your praises, to shout your praises, to speak your praise, to honor you with our lips, our eyes, our ears, our life. Help us each to realize we are missionaries to the places where you're sending us every day. Thank you, Lord, also for the ability to give love gifts and tithes and offerings for your honor and your glory, to say thank you to you for the huge and tremendous way you've provided everything for us. So now, Lord, we give these love gifts at the last Sunday of this year so that we might be obedient, but also so we can honor and bring glory to you. And all God's people said, amen, and Lord bless you. You may be seated as you give to the Lord today.
Faithful God forever.
Faithful like he? No one. Who loves us as much as he does? No one. Who cares for you so much that he would die for you? No one but Jesus. Lord, you are faithful to the end and forever for us and to us. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your compassion. Thank you for your presence each and every day, no matter what's happening in our life. You are there, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. All God's people said, amen, amen. You may be seated. And kids, you can be dismissed for children's church. Now, don't get all upset because they're not having donuts and steak and eggs or anything like that without us. So we'd put the kibosh on that one, I think. You know, I'm going to steal your coat rack. No, it's not a problem at all. Not a problem. My sitter downer got well acquainted with the parking lot ice slick out there Christmas Eve. But many, many times, you recall, Jesus read the scripture, shared, and then he took a seat. He was seated, and then he taught and shared from his heart. And I intend, I forgot. Another trip up. Tom, would you spare me, brother? If we could pass the pens around, and there's an outline, and there's a blank sheet. There's a sheet, the side of that sheet says 2014, and the back side says 2015. Don't start working on 2015 yet, but I'd like you to start just writing down on 2014 some of the things that you're thankful for this past year, things that you're grateful for to the Lord. It's a great way to end up a year. Is by being thankful. Amen? Because God has been so good to us. You know, there is no guarantee of tomorrow. How many of you, quite honestly, have had a coworker or a relative or a neighbor or someone in your community, circle of influence, pass away this last year? Anybody? Yeah, wow, several. Life is not... How many of them made an appointment and scheduled that and they knew that they were going to pass on and they got in touch with everybody? And just before they went home, I pray to be with the Lord, you had a party, right? Now, there's a message here, and there's a teaching. Go ahead and have those parties right away, because nobody schedules that. Amen? It comes on us that quick. It's amazing. In the twinkling of an eye, you can go from strong and vibrant to gone on. And then you go to stronger and more vibranter. That's not a word, is it? Well, you know what I mean. More energy, more life, more vigor. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for that promise. So, things that you're thankful for. I know that some of you can even write down the name of the decedent in the aforementioned paragraphs that we just spoke about. Some of those people who passed on, they were sick, they were aching, they were hurting. They were needy, and now they're not. They are freed. They are healed. They are strengthened. They are encouraged. All the above. Amen? What a blessing that is. Write that on your thankful side of that 2014, that sheet that's coming around. Be sure to write that down. Are you thankful for a significant other? Some of that's in process. I know for some people, they're working on that. What a blessing that is. That's cool. Do you have children? Are you thankful for them? Are they employed? Do they have a roof over their head? Do you have grandchildren from them? That should go on this list. Amen. Do you or your spouse have gainful employment? do you have insurance or the semblance thereof? The facsimile that's out there that might be insurance and might not, but it sure eats up the premiums. I'm sorry, there I went to meddling there. Do you have transportation? Are you grateful for that transportation? Did you have a bit to eat yesterday, last night? Aren't you grateful for that? Were you able to have a cup of coffee and maybe muffin or something this morning? Or are you looking forward to going out to lunch in just a bit? So you're hoping I don't go too long this morning. You can write down on this thankful list that Pastor Chris is going to preach quick this morning so we can go to lunch. Okay. not going to keep you long. I want to say, yes, yeah, I'm writing capital letters. Yep, short sermon, yay. Tom. Oh, your health, can you see? Can you pretty much hear? Do you still have a sense of humor? Ran into a gentleman this week who had absolutely no sense of humor whatsoever. I could make him chuckle or even grin. I even did the old, I'm going to keep my eye on you, took out my eye, put it down. I'm going to have to keep an eye on you, boy. He didn't crack a smile. You know? On second thought, I was afraid he was going to smash my eye. You know, those things are expensive. Oh, man. Yeah, I hear you. But I told him that I would pray for him. In fact, I didn't go away until I did pray for him. Have you had a chance during this holidays to sing to anybody? We were at Sam's Club with a couple of grandkids and my son, Jason. They're back at the computer cart, and we were picking up a couple last minute. Oh, gotta get these. And there was a little old gal there, probably had the onset of Alzheimer's, but very, very much elderly. And she was singing at the top of her lungs. Glory. And she mixed the songs together. I was so blessed by that. I looked around for people who were embarrassed or who were uneasy, and I just gave them the big old, hey, isn't that great? Smile. Just, ooh, I was rubbing. It's called, scripturally, it's called heaping coals of fire upon their head. That's what that is called. But it's biblical. Just keep being nice and then add a little more nice on top of it. That's how we're missionary, amen. That's how our testimony is by at this time, even if we don't have the biggest tree in town, we don't have the most presents, we don't have a shiny new car or a big, big bank account. We do have the child who created it all, came for us. We've received him as our Savior. He's promised he will never leave us. He'll never forsake us. So as we wrap up 2014, as we begin to look, and next Sunday we'll hit it even a little bit harder about our hope and about our future, we can truly say it's a wonderful life. It's a wonderful life. If. Now, a lot of people had this. It's a wonderful life if I got a raise. If only, you know that one? Oh, it's a wonderful life if only we wouldn't have had a car wreck this year, or the bank account wouldn't have drained, or I wouldn't have lost my job, or I wouldn't have broken my arm, or I wouldn't have fallen in the parking lot, or if. You know, if we're waiting for those ifs, there is no reason any day to be happy, because there's always something more. It's kind of like potato chips. One won't get the job done. And those of you, Jenny doesn't relate to this one, but Spanish peanuts, you know, with just the right amount of salt. And you just can't eat one of those or two of those. I love going to a ball game half because you get those peanuts and you crack them and they're all salty. Just try eating just one of those. No, it's never. And you know what? In our lives, too, there's always, well, the what ifs. If only. It's a wonderful life, and I'd like to fill in the if we entrust it to God every day, one day at a time. And that's the only way it can be a wonderful life. Now, you know this is a play off that black and white, good old Jimmy, is it Jimmy Stewart? Yeah, that movie, It's a Wonderful Life. Well, it is a wonderful life when God is your Father, Jesus, his Son, is your Savior, and the Holy Spirit lives inside of you, and he brings you the holiday each and every day. I really, the last couple Christmases, I come out of Christmas, and I really, I get this much down and depressed and kind of bummed, because I think we as Christians, we should ought to, you know, communion's a wonderful and beautiful thing, and we don't practice it every first Sunday of the month, because we do it quarterly, because we add to it a love feast and foot washing. Men wash men's feet, women wash women's feet. We're obedient to all of what's in John 13, that last night. Jesus said three times, wash feet. They had the meal. There was teaching involved with the food, with the bread, and with the cup. You have the Eucharist. But you know what? I almost think that the last Sunday of every month, no. The first Sunday of every month, Christians ought to celebrate Christmas all over again. I would love that. I mean, don't you sense in the world out there, even amongst the lost, the dark, they are giving. There are a few more smiles. There is a little bit more good cheer, a little bit more goodwill and caring at Christmas. Let me tell you why. It's not because of the gifts, it's because of the Christ that's in Christmas. And people way down in their heart, they really do yearn and desire and want and need for that void, that sin hole that's in their heart. They need to be that to be filled up with Jesus, filled up with God, and we need it to be done permanently. And that's the blessing of Jesus, amen? Not by works, lest any man should boast. You can't get baptized enough or join enough churches. You can't do enough good deeds. You can't speak as thou King James for the rest of thine life. It just won't. The only thing is Jesus, his blood sacrifice on the cross, from the manger to the cross to the grave, back to the Father. That's where our salvation comes from. How many of you deserve that? Do you deserve it? Raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. Please. None of us deserved it. There is none righteous, no, not one. We all deserve the alternative, eternity without God, without a relationship through Jesus. But God calls us and he gives us the greatest Christmas gift of all, eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. What kind of life? Eternal life. It's not temporary. Eternal life. Praise God. That's the good news. Well, Scripture, okay, have you been working on that? Are you thankful for some things? Now flip the sheet over. Be prepared throughout the rest of the time here to write down some of your hopes, your dreams, your visions, your needs, your prayers, what you would like to see God do in this next year. He can and will do them. Joshua 1:9 says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong, be courageous. Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." No matter the what-ifs that came into your life this last year, they're in the past. You cannot change them. They're done. They're over. Let go. You have today to work on with the Lord. You don't have even tomorrow or the next day. You don't have next Sunday. You have now with God. What are you going to do? Now. Only now. Now, does it mean we don't plan and prepare and pray and look towards the future? Yeah, we do. But I'll tell you what. The future will look much clearer if today in the now you're doing it with the Lord. Amen? If you're plumb up and down with him, if you're in line with him and what he wants you to do, he has promised the Lord your God will be with you whatever the ifs are. Ephesians 5:15 through 17. Be very careful then how you live. What is his will for us? I'm kind of answering that question. We need to be careful how we live. Not as unwise, but as wise. Making the most out of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Living in God's will makes today so, so special. It makes today his day. There's a video clip I'd like you to watch just for a moment. And the challenge from this is, let's make this year, his year. All right? Let's make this year, his year. And our prayer is that in you and I, that we will live faith that's seen in 2015. This year, take that T off this year and make it his year. Our prayer is that this next year, in all of our individual, our family, and our corporate as a church life, that we will have faith that's seen in 2015. Faith that's seen in 2015. We want to live it out. We want to be missionaries. And we are. God's called everyone, one of us, into full-time missionary work. Now, you might happen to be a dentist or a doctor or a secretary or a teacher or a coach or a computer or an IT person or work for the state or lawyer or whatever, but those are all your side jobs. Your full-time employment, according to God, is you're his missionary. I'm not the only guy in full-time ministry here. Amen? Amen. We all are. Philippians 3:10 through 14. Paul says, this is the goal. This is God's will for me and for us. I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings. Now, if you're a lot like me, I love that first phrase, in the power of his resurrection. Yeah, I want to beat up death. I want to overcome. And then it follows up with this, and the fellowship of his and participation of his sufferings. And I go, oh. You know, loved ones, as we have adopted for our church family, faith that's seen in 2015, do you know how that's going to appear and how that's going to show up? So when the things go wrong in your life and my life, when things get difficult, when things get tight, when things get hard, when the rest of the world would crash and burn, we're going to stand up and say, I belong to the child. I'm a child of the King of the universe. I belong to God, who is all-powerful, almighty. He is omnipresent. That means he's everywhere present. He is omnipotent. That means he is all-powerful. This is not going to get me down because I have a God who's willing any moment to take me up. If only, we'll do it his way. We'll yield to him. To become like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I've already obtained all of this perfection and what Paul's aiming at here. He says, I have not arrived already at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. I like that phrase, press on. And your outline, circle that one, press on, press on. Sometimes we have to press on. That means push and sweat and tears and go. Sometimes that means crawling on your knees, falling to the ground with that cross, and another brother or sister will come along and help us carry that cross. Loved ones, sometimes we have to press on, keep moving forward. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what's behind. Remember 2014? Great blessings. Thank you, Lord. Thank Him for Him. Glorify Him. But those problems and difficulties and the shortcuts and the ifs and the what ifs that occurred that said, if only that hadn't happened, you know what I'm talking about. Leave those behind. Strain towards, press towards, strain, work towards what is ahead. I press on to the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. One of the most exciting times in the Olympic events. I love track and field and the summer games. I love it in the sprints and those races. But it's amazing. Do you know that they can mark the time down to a thousandth of a second, and even one place farther than that, and I don't know what that's called, to find out who the winner is, because they are crossing the line so far. And you know what they do to cross that line to get there first? Some of them have literally you know what I'm talking about, right? They dove forward to get across that line first. They lean forward, they press forward with everything that they can so that they might. Loved ones, we need to do that. Some days we need to strain and press just to make it through the day. Amen. But you know what? Somebody said, I will be with you. I will help you do that. Oh, thank you, Lord, for those promises. Philippians 4:4-7. Paul begins to wrap up his letter to the church at Philippi. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say it, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Don't be anxious or worried or uptight, discouraged about anything, but in every situation, with prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Loved ones, this was Paul's goal. He says, hey, don't be anxious, don't fret, don't. Why? Because the Lord is near. That's the why of it. We are with prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God. Do you notice he didn't say, and he'll give you all that stuff. It's a magic wand. No. But his presence will bring his peace. Amen? In your life and mine. Thank you, Lord. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding and comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That means when the rest of the world would be on their knees or on their face crying out in disbelief and agony and pain, we can stand with calm and confidence and peace and assurance because our Heavenly Father's got it under control. He is in charge. If He knows when a sparrow hits the ground, if he knows the number of hairs on my head, and when he is pretty awesome and mighty, he can do it. He can do it. Philippians 4:10-13. This is one of Paul's secrets to being happy in the middle of the worst ifs and what ifs you could possibly imagine. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. You remembered that I was in need, basically, is what he's saying here. Indeed, you were concerned so much so, but you had no opportunity to show it. You didn't have the ability to send me any gifts or to support me or to help me. I'm not saying this because I'm in need now. And he's saying, hey, I'm not bringing this up because I want you to send me a bunch of gifts, you know. Sometimes that happens, doesn't it? Yeah, that happens sometimes. But he says, I have learned to be content in whatever the circumstances. Now, in case we don't understand what he's saying, look what he's saying. I know what it is to be in need, to be empty. I know what it means to have plenty or to abound or to overflow. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want, in need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's the King James. NIV says, I can do all this through him who gives me strength. And who is our source of strength? Jesus Christ. If you're a store owner, it's not the customer. If you're a government worker, it's not the government. If you're a school teacher, it's not the administration. If you're a secretary, it's not those who oversee you. If you're in the military, it's not those who supervise you. If you're a subcontractor, you're self-employed, it's not all those contracts. Amen? Amen? It is the Lord, Jesus Christ. It's God who gives us strength. Jeremiah 29, 11 through 13, as we look towards the future, we look to this next year, I want us to remember the words of the Lord our God. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. Loved ones, God has a plan for you and I. Now let me clarify, because we want to be faithful to the text and to the Word of God. That promise was not written initially on the top level of prophecy to you and I. That was written to some very specific people in the Old Testament for a very important reason at a very important time. But the principle absolutely applies to us today. It is still as true for us, the bride of Christ, the army of Christ, the family of God, as it was for the children of Israel when they received that prophecy so many years ago. God knows the plans he has for you. Plans not for distress, but to prosper us. Plans to give us a hope and a future. As you look to 2015, I hope you've written down some things on the hope, prayer, dream, visionize. And I hope they were big plans. If there's any problem that the church today has, it's number one, we don't pray enough. We don't ask God. In James, he says, you have not because you ask not. You're not asking me. We have much to ask God for in 2015. The mall still may be on that path to remove us from the facility. We got a month's notice back in the summer, and they've extended, and they've said, okay, well, till next summer and maybe beyond. But, you know, we need to continue to say, Lord, is this where you want us to be? And we'll do that one day at a time, one week at a time, one month at a time. And then God will make it very evident to us the right place at the right time for the right amount, and he's going to have to do that. That's going to require miracles for all that to happen. I can't make it happen. We can't make it happen. Only God can work that all out. Wow, 2015. Faith that's seen in 2015. So that's just one area that we as a church family need to exhibit faith. Financially, God has blessed us so much this year. Wonderful gifts and wonderful things. Many things that weren't even finances came. We still struggle in that area, but every family is struggling somewhat in that area. Thank you for being faithful to the Lord, though, first. Thank you for giving to him. I know that he is blessing you. He will continue to bless you as you do it his way. And as you say, okay, God, you're going to have to fill the fridge because this tithe money was what we were going to spend on bread and bologna. But God can make it happen. And by the end of that week, many times at our house, there's been a roast and some potatoes in the pantry and some vegetables to go with it. Why? Because God is faithful. He has plans for you and me. Well, I want to wrap it up by doing this. All of you perhaps have family members. You may not have children or grandchildren, but if you have, how many of you have children? Let's just go that. Do you have children? How many of you have grandchildren? Good. Now, how many of you have other loved ones that are still living. It's amazing. Marsh and I have met a couple people in the last couple years. They have no living relatives left, period. No aunts, uncles, cousins, no nobody. That's where you really highlight the fact that they can be your blood relative through the blood of Jesus, and they are your family, and you are theirs. Amen? That's how we live it out as a church. Here's my question. What kind of plans do you have for your kids, for your grandkids? Your goal is you want your kids just to grow up as dumb as they can be and live at home till they're 50 in your basement playing video games. Yeah, right? Yeah? Yeah. They got to wrestle you for the controller. Loved ones, we would plan good things and wonderful things and awesome things for our children. Amen. I bet you didn't read down the Christmas list this year and say, bah, humbug, not getting any of that. You wanted to get them just, if you're like, I don't know if you're like me, I want to give them everything I possibly can on the list. And I get in so much trouble. Don't I get in trouble? Yeah, I get in trouble all the time. I want to give them what's on the list and more that they didn't know they wanted. You know what? That's how God is for you and I. He knows the plans that he has for you and I. Plans to prosper us and do mighty and wonderful things so that our faith might be seen in 2015. That's his plan. He wants you to shine for him, to be his missionary. Lord, thank you for this time together. Thank you for your word and the light to our path, the lamp to our feet that it is. Lord, help us to, this week, apply the scripture where Paul said, forgetting the past, I press on, I struggle, I strain for the future. And Lord, help us to remember this admonition. You said, any man or woman who has put their hands to the plow and looks back is not worthy of the kingdom of heaven. God, help us to remember that we are your plowsmen and women. And when we have our hands on that plow, we need to be looking down the line so we can keep the row straight and make it to the destination. Lord, help us to strain, to press on, to be obedient. And all God's people said, please keep your heads bowed and eyes closed just for a moment. Did you write anything on the 2015 list yet? There's some huge things I know lots of families are struggling with. Is it finances? Is it housing? Are there projects around the house? Is it your transportation? Is it health issues for you or for others? Is it wisdom to know how to minister this year and how to serve? Oh, loved ones, God wants those things from you. Those are the gifts he's looking for Christmas. You want to give gifts at the New Year's? He'll take them for New Year's. Each and every day, he wants those things. He wants to mold them and shape them and adjust them. If you do have some visions and dreams and needs, heads are bowed, eyes are closed, I promise you. Just lift up your hand and put it back down just so I can pray for you. Good, good. Praise the Lord. Now, you're not lifting your hand to me. You're lifting your hand up to the Lord. Amen? Praise the Lord. Good, good. Lord God, again, we thank you. Your ways are not our ways. Your thoughts are not our thoughts. You have something even more than our list could ever write down. We thank you that he who has begun a good work in us will continue to perform it until the day that you return and we join you in heaven, Lord God. Thank you for your faithfulness, even when we are not faithful. And all God's people said, amen, and they said glory and hallelujah and praise the Lord and whoa, thank you, God. And it has been good to have been in the house of the Lord. Thank you for being here with me, with the Lord, with your church family today for this church family reunion. Even those first-timers who now are part of the family, I mean, they're part of the reunion, right? We're blood related. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. God bless. You may be dismissed. Thank you.
The wondrous cross. into his blood. See from his head, his hands, his feet. So love demands my soul.
My
life, my
on the ball there.
Two more minutes and see where.
Thank you.
Well, we will be praying for you, and I'll get in touch. We'll start a little prayer list.
Yeah, because right now we aren't
doing that.
Right. Something to break loose up for you.